Good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church. We're so glad that you could join us on this Pentecost Sunday. We pray that you, as you watch with us today and worship with us, that you will feel the presence of the Spirit here with you on this day. Welcome. We're so glad you're here. Open to your presence in our church and in our lives. Fill us with your wind and fire that we might be enlivened again. Help us hear the words as if for the first time, that they might touch us anew. Give us visions and dreams of what you long for in your creation, so that we might begin to live them into reality. Come, Spirit, come into our worship, into our church, into our very selves, so we can go out into the world bringing your Spirit of unity and love. Amen.
Thank you.
Would you please join us in the responsive reading? Spirit of joy, come like the wind swirling among us. Fill us with enthusiasm and energize us to do your work and your will.
Thank you, God, for the spirit of joy.
Spirit of truth, come as the flame of Christ's light among us, shining in our hearts, our minds, and our lives.
Thank you, God, for the spirit of truth.
Spirit of life, come as the breath of life, pouring energy and power into our dry bones, rekindling those who are weary, that we may have life and know God.
Thank you, God, for the spirit of life.
Spirit of hope, come from the four winds, breathing upon all your people, that all creation may be renewed with hope.
Thank you, God, for the spirit of hope.
Spirit of love, come as our comforter and consoler, so that all who are broken and wounded are healed, so that all who grieve may be consoled by the power of your love and grace.
Thank you, God, for the spirit of love.
Spirit of wisdom, come as the light of understanding, that diversity in all its forms may be understood as something to cherish.
Thank you, God, for the spirit of wisdom.
Spirit of peace, come as the winds of truth, that our hearts may be kindled by the passion for justice and peace.
Thank you, God, for the spirit of peace. Amen.
Amen. Would you please bow your heads in prayer? Holy God, we come to you on this Pentecost Sunday, all together in this place, just as the disciples were all together on that day so long ago. We pray that, like on that day, we may feel your spirit move among us today, that we may feel the winds of change, hope, guidance, and wisdom move through our congregation. We pray that your spirit may give us visions and dreams for the future, a future where we can see the kingdom of God, God's kingdom of love, justice, and mercy as a living presence among us. May your spirit give us the courage to step out of our comfort zones and our safe places, the courage to speak, the courage to cross boundaries and to boldly share the good news. Wind of the Spirit, blow through us today. We pray for courage because so often we are afraid. We pray for guidance because so often we feel lost. We pray for wisdom because so often we don't know what to do. Wind of the Spirit, blow through us today. We pray for forgiveness. Forgiveness for the many ways we have failed and fallen short. We pray for forgiveness for the hurt and pain we have caused others. We pray for forgiveness for the hurt and pain that we have brought on ourselves. We pray for forgiveness for the times we have forgotten you, God, and have wandered off down the wrong path. We pray for forgiveness for the times we have failed to love, the times we have failed to act, the times we have failed to speak, the times we have failed to listen. Wind of the Spirit, blow through us today. We pray for healing. We pray for healing for the brokenness in the world, the violence, the war, the hunger, the fear, the division and anger, the grief, the greed, the pain and the injustice. And we pray especially for healing and peace in Burma. We pray for healing in our congregation. We pray for healing for relationships and families. We pray for healing from addictions. We pray for healing for those who are recovering from illness and for those with long-term health conditions and the challenges that come with age. We pray especially today for Reagan and Theo, young people facing injury and serious medical conditions. We pray for those who grieve for loved ones who have been lost, and for losses of so many kinds. Wind of the Spirit, blow through us today. Holy God, we know that Jesus promised his followers that he would not leave them alone, but that the Spirit would come to be with them. And we know this is true because we have felt the winds of the Spirit blow through our lives. We have felt the comfort, the guidance, the wisdom, and the courage that your Spirit has brought to us again and again. Thank you, God, for the gift of your Spirit. Open us that we may feel that Spirit with us and in us today. Wind of the Spirit, blow through us today. Amen. Would you now join me in saying the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Incline thine ear to us and grant us thy peace.
It's the end of the world as we know it. 35 years ago, the rock band REM came out with a big hit song, "It's the End of the World as We Know It, and I Feel Fine." That phrase was repeated over and over and over again, "It's the end of the world as we know it." Recently, someone commented on Facebook that it seemed that this should be the theme song for the year 2020. And I would agree. With the pandemic, so many things have changed. We left a lot of things behind, and our lives are different now. With the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, I'm sure that the early disciples felt that it was the end of the world as they knew it. The world as they had known it had ended. But in reality, the world as they knew it had ended several times already. Life as they knew it ended when Jesus first invited them to follow. "Drop their nets, come and follow me." They left what was familiar to them to trust in and follow Jesus. The way they made their livings, where they lived, who they lived with, all these things changed when they said yes to Jesus' call. Their lives as they knew them died when Jesus died on the cross. They had invested 3 years believing and basing their lives on the words of their master. Who they were and what they were supposed to be now. What was the point of the last 3 years if Jesus was dead? It was the end of their world as they knew it. And then their lives, as they knew them, got flipped up on their heads once again, with the report of the empty tomb and Jesus' startling appearance in their midst behind locked doors. Jesus showed them the marks of death on his hands and his feet, and yet there he was alive. What did that mean for them? And now, as the powerful wind and tongues of flame descended on them at Pentecost, life as they knew it was over, and a new life was beginning. Acts 2, the first 8 verses. When the day of Pentecost came, all the believers were gathered together in one place. Suddenly there was a noise from the sky which sounded like a strong wind blowing, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And they saw what looked like tongues of fire, which spread out and touched each person there. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to talk in other languages as the Spirit enabled them. There were Jews living in Jerusalem, religious people who had come from every country in the world. And when they heard the noise, a large crowd gathered, and they were all excited because all of them heard and the believers talking in their own languages. In amazement and wonder, they exclaimed, "These people who are talking, these are Galileans. How is it then that all of us hear them speaking in our own native language?" May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This whole movement that Jesus had started was no longer of local importance only. Now the whole world is being invited to become followers of Jesus. In all different languages, God's mighty acts of grace and power were preached and were understood. I think that sometimes we get caught up in the drama of the first Pentecost. It is important that the disciples witnessed the tongues of flame and felt the rush of wind. It was an ecstatic moment, and it probably will not happen that way again in the same way. But I believe that what is most important to us is what was going on within them, inside, invisible, the personal experience of the followers of Jesus as they experienced the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Now their lives were changed as Jesus' Spirit moved in them and shaped them. Fearful disciples became bold apostles. Dispirited followers became spirited leaders. Students became teachers when the disciples learned that Jesus was forever present with them. Pentecost is often called the birthday of the church, but this Sunday, I would suggest that we call it a graduation of the church. Followers of Jesus, inspired by the Holy Spirit, imitated Jesus and became witness to his life and teachings, his death and resurrection. The disciples became apostles, that is, people who are sent out. A couple of weeks ago, Sheila talked about the graduation of Peter as Jesus confronted him by the Sea of Galilee after his death and resurrection. Peter became a different person when Jesus told him to feed my sheep. Peter knew he was loved and was reconciled to his master, and it was this continuing presence of that love in his life that allowed him to be the one upon whom Jesus would build his church. Now, the graduation of the church happened as the apostles were personally inspired and experienced the living presence of Christ. It was then that they became Christ's body. This graduation, this end of the world as they knew it, they graduated to a new world. It was not just a shared memory of Jesus that was keeping this new movement alive, because Christianity would have died out long ago if it relied only on the memory of what Jesus had taught. It is Jesus' living presence upon which the life of the church depends. The gift of the Holy Spirit is just that, a gift. The disciples did not earn it or somehow struggle to create it. The amazing thing that they did was to be obedient to Jesus' instruction. They waited, and they waited together. Our text said that they gathered to pray. How often we are too busy to wait and pray, because we would much rather do something. We might have expected the disciples to go out and do something, some useful activity. Jesus had told them that they would be witnesses to the ends of the world, but now they were to wait and pray. William Willimon said, The action demanded of the church is more than busyness and strenuous human activity. The disciples have been told that the promised gift to be given in God's own time and that the promised Spirit is also by God's grace. Their mission will require more than ever, more than even their most earnest striving. During Jesus' earthly ministry, the disciples were often depicted as mildly confused and not really understanding what Jesus was talking about. But they got it right this time. They waited and they prayed. Waiting and praying are the primary activities of a faithful church then and now. When we prayerfully wait for God to guide us, for God to act by power and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, we are testifying that the most important things that we need to get done in this world are beyond our ability to accomplish by our own effort or wisdom or strength. Christians continue to wait and pray for the gifts and the coming of the Holy Spirit because it is only God who can give the church what the church most desperately needs. We sometimes don't look beyond the fireworks and the mini tornado of the Pentecost story. I would invite us to be mindful of the purpose of Pentecost, the reason behind Pentecost. Why was this supernatural, unpredictable power unleashed on the church? The very life of this congregation is a product of the Holy Spirit. Without the Spirit, First Baptist Church is just a nonprofit social service club. We have been given life, and we have been given continued breath in order to serve and to work for the common good of our community. We have been charged with a message of hope and healing. Pentecost is experienced and it is renewed in us as we live out and exercise the gifts that we have been given. Our life is renewed as we serve others and as the kingdom of God is preached and served. Trusting the Spirit of God means we are willing to wait, to pray, and then act with confidence, believing that the love and the presence of God will sustain and guide us, as the Spirit did on that first Pentecost. Usually we say, I'll believe it when I see it. Pentecost promises that I will see it when I believe it. I believe it when I reflect on these past 2 years. Just before COVID hit, we were making plans and developing ways to work together, Karen and American Born, two becoming one. I was excited about what was happening with the creation of a combined leadership team whose task was to envision what our future together could look like. And then all of a sudden, we couldn't be together. We couldn't even meet together. Things were just put on hold, and we waited. But as we waited, we continued to pray. And now, as we are beginning to cautiously awaken from our COVID isolation and hibernation, we're picking up where we left off. But I think that because of this period of waiting, we are experiencing this new beginning differently, because we know deep in our hearts how important community is, because we experience the lack of it, and how important it is to be together because we couldn't be together. We now have a greater appreciation of one another, and this will help us to shape our plans as we move forward. God has brought us this far, and we realize that we need to trust that God will continue to lead us, not just to survive, but to thrive as the body of Christ in this place. We celebrate Pentecost, not because it happened 2,000 years ago, but because it promises to happen to us today, in our time. Because only God can give the church what it desperately needs, this life-giving infusion of the Spirit. As at the first Pentecost, the most important thing that happened was that the apostles experienced an inward and important change. They were empowered by God, and God unleashed the Spirit in unexpected ways and people and places, and God continues to do that today when we are open, when we have waited, when we have prayed, and then when we have stepped out boldly, confidently, that God is with us. God is with us. We sang these words already, but I repeat them now. So may we be empowered to do the right, living from darkness into dawning light. So shall the word, still like a burning fire, be all the truth and wisdom we require, flashing new insight, making vision clear, revealing Christ among us, now and here. O God, give us ears to listen, and tongues aflame with praise. Amen. In the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and the communion, the strengthening and the power of the Holy Spirit, be and abide in you, now and forever. Amen. And go in peace.